Okay, so I will continue to, and proceed to the last presentation by our keynote speaker entitled Leveraging Technology to Promote Access, Quality, and Effective Governance in Higher Education, Perspectives from UNESCO Bangkok by Dr. Libing Wang. Dr. Wang Libing, a professor of education, Xinjiang University, People's Republic of China, received his doctoral degree at Hangzhou University, China in 1994. He specializes in cooperative education, higher education policies, and teacher education. He is currently a university professor at the College of Education, Xinjiang University, China. He was a visiting fellow at the University of Sussex, United Kingdom from 1992 to 1993 and the University of Warwick from 1998 to 1999. Since 2000, his work has been closely linked with UNESCO as he was appointed as director of UNESCO APET Associate Center at Xinjiang University and secretary at the Global University Network for Innovation, Asia and the Pacific, a UNESCO-initiated regional network that brings together leading universities in this region for experience sharing and partnership building. Distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Wang Libing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, for your kind introduction. I'm now working in UNESCO Bangkok already for almost for 4 years. Before that, I was a professor of education in Zhejiang University of China. And I'm now chief of the section, which is in charge of higher education, teacher education, ICT in education, education for sustainable development, and technical and vocational education and training. So we have a very big mandate, actually. And I'm around for all the meetings. That's part of my job attending all the meetings. But I'm really happy to be here because this is really an area that we want to promote. As you can see, in my section, actually, we haven't done a lot on the use of technology in education. It obviously being one of our priority areas is to promote the use of technology in higher education. I would like to start with a very brief introduction of the new global sustainable agenda. As you know, UN system, we are adopting a very long-term planning approach. We are planning for every 15 years. So in the year 2000, United Nations came up with the so-called Millennium Development Goals, which ended last year in the year 2015. And then now we have new agenda, new development goals, which is SDG, we call it Sustainable Development Goals, which are covering all areas of human life. And you can see, you can see SDG 4 is specifically for education. And the UNESCO was actually fighting for our separate SDG goals, and we did it, which means that under the new agenda, SDG, we have a very standalone SDGs, which is to promote inclusive quality and education and lifelong learning for all. So for us, we always link all our activities to these SDGs and SDGs 4. In this area, I think the new agenda is very comprehensive, as you can see from these slides. Compared with the previous Millennium Development Goals, this one is very comprehensive, covering areas from early childcare and education to adult learning and lifelong learning. And so, you know, from this new agenda, you can see more visibility of technical and vocational education and training, and also higher education. And in this, for this new agenda, actually, it's quite clear that the use of ICTs, the roles of ICTs in the achievement of these new SDGs is very critical and widely recognized. As you can see from this ICTs, particularly mobile technology, holds a great promise for accelerating progress in achieving these new SDGs. I would like to draw your attention to some of our UNESCO's normative documents. One of the most recent normative document is the Qingdao Declaration, which was adopted soon after the World Forum on Education in the Republic of Korea. We came up with the new Education 2030, and after Yingchuan Forum, there was a meeting organized by UNESCO in Qingdao, People's Republic of China. And this meeting came up with a declaration called the Qingdao Declaration. You can see, actually, it's quite clear for UNESCO that ICTs has a lot of benefits. But mainly, all the benefits are around three dimensions. The first one is to promote access to education. And it's a cost-effective way to promote more people to get access to education. Of course, computers, all the infrastructures are very expensive. But compared with the construction of the, you know, real buildings, schools, it's been regarded as a cost-effective solutions to promote access to education. Secondly, it's also related to quality of education. Many people are very skeptical about the use of ICT. They said, oh, we are now losing people-to-people interpersonal contact because of the introduction of the machines. And maybe in the future, we will remember this traditional way of delivering education based on face-to-face personal interaction. You will remember these good, you know, days where you were educated with your teachers, you know, closely, and now you are facing a machine, right? So we are really very much remember the benefits of eating something which is handmade, right? But people said we are not going into a period where education is not handmade, it's machine made. So these kind of things, I think we should also take into account, and the quality, if it's necessary, I think we need to convince people that by introducing more technology-based innovations, is it good for the quality of education? And lastly, I think the benefits is also about effectiveness and the transparency of the education management and governance and management system. So it's three dimensions, and we are looking at the benefits of the use of ICT. So the first one is, of course, access. And I really appreciate what Khun Anucha has just presented about the national initiatives in Thailand. You made a lot, you know, every region, you know, key universities as an e-learning hub, try to reach unreached people. But for us, what we understand is that we do not use MOOCs quite often. It's not a UNESCO terminology, but we use open and distance learning. And MOOCs is one of open and distance learning. And you can see with the development of infrastructure, especially the increasing penetration rate of the broadband service, we can see actually there's a great potential for us to leverage the technology for promoting access. We also highly recommend governments to recognize quality assured online courses as part of alternative or complementary modes to face-to-face study programs. But we are very cautious when it comes to basic education. We would see that we would see governments to introduce a common framework for all the kids, rather than create another system, which is through non-traditional modalities, by introducing more skill-based vocational type education to the students who may out of school because of economic reason. And we don't think this kind of arrangement can be institutionalized. So I think this is just a different way of delivery rather than creating another ways of schooling, which is totally different from the mainstream school system, which is not very much encouraged. Because as we understand, basic education should be free, should be compulsory, with a single curriculum standards. After compulsory education, there might be different streams, right? Vocational, academic, all these kind of things. So this is the things I would like to share with you. Secondly, of course, open and distance learning used to be offered by traditional open university systems. So we always say that open universities, they are more advanced in integrating technology in their programs, right? And traditional universities are always very slow in introducing this kind of e-learning programs. But actually we would like to expand open and distance learning to traditional universities, either by introducing more blended learning programs or MOOCs to reach the disadvantaged group. It's quite clear that for every higher education institutions, there are three pillars of university teaching. One is for undergraduate, second is for postgraduate, and the third pillar is to serve the adult learners with continuing and the professional development programs, right? And we should actually we should develop more open and distance learning programs for this non-traditional learners, and also to targeting this disadvantaged group. Another issue is also very important, because when every time I attended a similar meeting like this, I would see different groups of people. Some are specialized in technology. Some are pedagogy experts. But some, and we do not very much engage people in the subject, right? But actually, any successful MOOCs or open and distance learning program is depending on the close collaboration between this group of three group of people. Before I came to UNESCO, I got to know that actually in China sometimes these three group of people not easy to work together, right? And you can see a lot of bad stories. Some are dominated by technology people, some are driven by pedagogy people. And it's not, I think we need to think of establishing a post in the universities which can call chief learning architect. It's not learning and teaching center, right? We have a lot of universities who already established teaching and the learning center, try to give staff training on technology, on the use of technology, and also training on pedagogical issues. But it's not enough. I think for every higher education institution, like every bank, they have a chief economist. I think university and higher education is basically a learning institution. We need to think of, you know, establish a post called chief learning architect, which is beyond these three dimensions of technology, pedagogy, and content, and to define, you know, so overarching visions, objectives, domains of learning, which is in line with national qualifications framework, which can also distinguish your university from other universities. You can adopt different modes, you know, you can adopt different theories, constructivism, you know, all these kind of things. And we would like, actually, a university to think of these options. Because as far as I know, actually, faculty, although many universities have faculty of education, but many are marginalized. They are not very much utilized to support teaching and learning in the universities. And actually, people who are in charge of teaching and learning is sometimes not well qualified in terms of training. Right? So this kind of things, I would say, is very important. And we need to have an overarching concept design for the whole university. I don't know if Thailand is in the process of developing your national qualifications framework in line with the ASEAN qualifications reference framework. But this is also, I think, very important. And I think this should be, you know, the way forward for many of the universities, if you would like really to promote the use of technology in your university. Of course, this is the Qingdao Declaration, which says that the use of technology has a lot of benefits. But I would like to draw your attention to the justifications why the use of technology can enhance the quality of education provision. It's quite clear that with the use of technology, especially mobile technology, internet, students can have more experience, learning experiences, and with many learning resources, right? Internet is the biggest open educational resources. Although you have to pay for getting access, right? But it's the largest, and you have a lot of search engine, right? Also, we have Wikipedia, right? Or many things. In the past, teacher had the monopoly of knowledge because there's no other teaching materials, learning materials. But now, maybe students can have more information than the teachers. So this kind of things is really, the environment is really changing. And we can see the use of technology also is helpful in promoting individualized learning. Right? Do not need to follow the same session, right? For all the students. And it's also more interactive with other learning partners. And I would say that we have seen the increasing use of blended learning in Australia. You can see some even adopt the model of 70% of the teaching hours is online, 70, and face-to-face is only 30. So I think this kind of practice need, you know, us to think of introducing more online learning modality, but of course face-to-face is also very important. For UNESCO, I would like to recommend you to have a look at two normative documents, which is the first one is UNESCO Commonwealth of Learning joint guidelines for open educational resources. And another one is a Paris Declaration on Open Educational Resources. And I think MOOCs should be serving as an important way to deliver open educational resources in higher education. And we are actually now organizing regional meetings to take stock of the best policies and the practices from our member states. Of course, we need to think of the development of MOOCs from OER perspectives. This can be regarded as a social responsibility of higher education institutions. UNESCO is not very much in favor of over-commercialization of MOOCs. We encourage governments and higher education institutions to develop more OER-oriented MOOCs. So this is very important. And I think for every higher education institutions, we need to think of developing an institutional strategies for the use of ICT in education, including MOOCs, policies on MOOCs and blended learning. We would like to suggest when you are doing your institutional planning, please think of the use of technology in the delivery and the management of education in your university. Recently, we just got approved of a project which will be benefiting two countries, Sri Lanka and Cambodia. The objective is to actually provide capacity building to two flagship universities of IUPP, Royal University of Phnom Penh and the University of Colombo, to develop their institutional capacity in the use of ICTs. For teaching and learning innovation. So this is something, you know, we are going to do with support actually from the Korea government of the Republic of Korea. Another issue will be the will be related to collective knowledge construction. As you know, nowadays MOOCs or the network, MOOCs network are almost dominated by the developed countries, right? And we are facing, you know, the danger of losing our indigenous knowledge. And as an intergovernmental organization, UNESCO should have a voice. Because one of the motivations for the development of MOOCs is to democratize the knowledge production process, right? But what we see is actually that many of the star professors, their lectures, their lesson plan, their videos are widespread, right? And every young or junior professors or junior teaching staff, they are following this. When it comes to countries, also, we need to think of the capacity of the developing countries. We need to encourage localization or customization, this kind of process. So I think this is one of the areas we are very much concerned. We would like to encourage countries to collaborate with each other, which can be leading to collective knowledge construction. We would also like countries to pay more attention to protect your indigenous knowledge. Another issue which is also very important is MOOCs and its relation with cross-border higher education. It's quite clear that if we introduce foreign MOOCs, it's really being related to cross-border supply. If they are leading to certification or leading to diplomas or qualifications. And I don't know what's the terms, you know, of Thailand or other countries. When you are joining WTO, you make a commitment to open your market, right? And the cross-border supply, do you make any concession? You promise market access to cross-border supply, which means any other foreign universities, they can actually offer online learning. And their qualifications are recognized in your country. Which means you do not need to go to New York. And you can get master degree, even PhD degree from a university in New York. I don't know what's the status of countries, you know, when it comes to your commitment to the general agreement on the trade in services. But I think it's quite clear that I think foreign MOOCs should be regulated. I don't think every country would like all the teaching and the learning content be decided by people outside the country. So this is something I think we would like member states to collaborate, actually. You cannot simply, you know, providing this so-called cross-border supply of higher education programs. Foreign MOOCs that are part of joint study programs that can be leading to to domestic certification, I think it's subject to the regulation of the domestic quality assurance system, right? And we would also like to encourage countries to work together to develop joint MOOCs based on MOUs. So this is the kind of things I think we would very much encourage, and we thought that credit recognition and the transfer is also very important. Of course, the last dimension is about governance, and it's also quite clear that according to Qingdao Declaration, the use of ICT is very important for transparency of decision-making process, governance, you know, and also effectiveness and efficiency of the system, which is evidence-based, data-supported, and of course, we have a lot of information management system, right? So this is the three dimensions I think UNESCO would like to see the benefits of the use of technology. For us, actually, we haven't done a lot, actually, but the ongoing things we are doing is a project, as I mentioned earlier. We just got a project approved, which will be building staff capacity for ICT-driven innovation in Cambodia and Sri Lanka. And we are going to target two flagship universities. This project will be launched very soon. We are also going to organize a meeting together with our partner in Korea, National Institute of Lifelong Learning, to organize a meeting on MOOCs as a catalyst to enhance teaching and lifelong learning in Asia and the Pacific. And we are planning to invite participants from 10 or 11 countries to the meeting, which will be held in Seoul in collaboration with our partners, local partners, which is NIO. And we are going to publish a publication, which is actually ready for printing, based on one of our project, which is to build the capacity of higher education institutions for blended learning. We collected many case studies from Korea, from China, from Indonesia, from Malaysia, Australia, from many countries in this region. And now we are going to publish a book. I realize that in this region, we do not have the tradition of easily recognize, something which is not based on face to face, right? So this is something I think we need to clearly think of: what's the benefits, what's the risks, and how this kind of program can be quality assured. So this is something I think I would like to share with you. I'm not counting the times, but I would be happy if there's any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Libing. And we still have a few minutes for questions and answer. If you have. So now, actually, we still have 10 minutes before our lunch break. And in the afternoon, there are still the current concurrent sessions in six rooms. So please don't forget to bring your notebook computer with you. And also the certificate will be awarded only for participants who attended both days of the conference. And the certificate can be received on July 29th, it means today, at 3 p.m. at the registration counter. So don't forget, in the program bulletin, you have the evaluation form for the second day and also the last day of the IEC 2016. Thank you so very much for our seven keynote speakers for the two-day conference. And most heartfelt thanks to all participants who have shown up your interest and participation. The luncheons will be served at the same room as yesterday, 203 and also 222. And we'll meet again for next year, IEC Conference 2017. Thank you and goodbye.